Good evening. I'd like to call this meeting to order, please. Welcome to a meeting of the Hunterdon Central Regional High School Board of Education. Please be advised that this and all meetings of the board are open to the public and media, consistent with the Open Public Meetings Act, NJSA 10:4-6, and that advance notice required therein has been provided. Meeting notice was also posted in the boardroom of the Upper School campus, sent to the Courier News, Star Ledger, Express Times, and the Hunterdon County Democrat, and sent to the clerks of Delaware Township, East Amwell Township, Flemington Borough, Raritan Township, and Reddington Township. The public will have an opportunity to be heard as shown on the agenda. May we stand for a flag salute, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Tonight is our reorganization of the Board of Education, and we do have three new elected members to our board. Delaware Township, we have Mr. Kane Fowler to a three-year term. Flemington Borough, we have Mrs. Noelle O'Donnell to a three-year term. And Reddington Township, we have Mrs. Lori Blutfeld also to a three-year term. There has been correspondence received by the Board of Education, and that will be held in the business office on file. If I could please have Mr. Fowler, Mrs. O'Donnell, and Mrs. Blutfeld come forward to be sworn into office, please. If you can raise your hands, please, your right hand, and repeat after me. I, and state your name, do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of New Jersey, and that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, and to the governments established in the United States and this state, under the authority of the people, so help me God. I, and state your name, do solemnly swear that I possess the qualifications of membership prescribed by law, including specifically that I am not disqualified as a voter pursuant to RS 19:4-1, as well as I am not disqualified due to a conviction of a crime or offense listed in NJSA 18A-12-1. And I state your name. Do solemnly swear that I possess the qualifications prescribed by law for the office of member of the Board of Education. And that I will faithfully, impartially, and justly perform all the duties of that office. According to the best of my ability, so help me God. Congratulations, thank you. At this time, I'd like to open the floor for nominations for the position of Board of Education President.
I'd like to nominate Lisa Hughes.
Second.
Are there any others? May I take a roll call vote for Mrs. Hughes to be the board president for the 22 school year? Sorry. Mrs. Blutfeld? Oh. Yes, thank you. Mr. Charney?
Yes.
Mr. Davidson?
Yes.
Mr. Fowler?
Yes.
Mrs. Hughes?
I'll abstain on that vote.
Mrs. Kellogg?
Yes.
Mr. Nickel?
Yes.
Mr. Richard?
Yes.
And Mrs. O'Donnell?
Yes.
By unanimous vote, Mrs. Hughes has been nominated as the board president. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So we move on to nomination of the vice president. Do I have a motion for nomination of vice president?
I nominate Rob Richard for vice president.
Second.
Any other nominations? Hearing none, can we take a roll call vote, please?
Mrs. Blutfeld?
Yes.
Mr. Charney?
Yes.
Mr. Davidson?
Yes.
Mr. Fowler?
Yes.
Mrs. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Kellogg?
Yes.
Mr. Nickel?
Yes.
Mr. Richard?
Abstain.
And Mrs. O'Donnell?
Yes.
All yes. Congratulations, Mr. Richard.
Thank you. So I just want to say thank you and appreciate the confidence of the rest of the board members. I know I have big shoes to fill with Mr. Panico no longer being here, and I will do my best to fulfill my duties in the role of president. So I appreciate the support and confidence of the rest of the board. So off we go. We have the board member code of ethics that each board member needs to sign. Ms. Spitzer left a copy on your desks. Please make sure you sign that and return that to Ms. Spitzer. We will have some ethics training later in the year, as we always do. We'll move on to the organizational items. Do we need to approve minutes from December meeting? I didn't see that on the agenda. Gotcha. Great.
Do we need to adopt the code of ethics officially through a vote? We just need to do the
We need a motion on that?
Yeah.
Okay. Can I have a motion and a second to adopt the code of ethics for this year?
So moved.
Second.
Move.
We have a motion and a second. Can I have a roll call vote, please?
Mrs. Blutfeld?
Yes.
Dr. Charney?
Yes.
Mr. Davidson?
Yes.
Mr. Fowler?
Yes.
Mrs. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Kellogg?
Yes.
Mr. Nickel?
Yes.
Mr. Richard?
Yes.
And Mrs. O'Donnell?
Yes.
All yes, motion carries.
Thank you. Next on the agenda is we need a motion to readopt all existing bylaws and policies. Do I have a motion and a second?
So moved.
Second.
Is there any discussion? May I have a roll call vote, please?
Mrs. Blutfeld?
Should I be abstaining from this? Is this something we're supposed to take a look at ahead of time?
I don't think there's any conflicts. I think you'd be okay to vote on it if you feel comfortable.
Yes. Dr. Charney?
Yes.
Mr. Davidson?
Yes.
Mr. Fowler? Mrs. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Kellogg?
Yes.
Mr. Nickel?
Yes.
Mr. Richard?
Yes.
And Mrs. O'Donnell?
Yes.
All yes, motion carries.
Thank you. Next on the agenda is the reestablishment of board committees. I'll need a motion and a second to reestablish all our existing standing committees and ad hoc committees pursuant to policy 155. Do we have a motion and a second?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. O'Donnell?
Yes, I think given all the work that the board's been doing and the pressing nature of the equity work, I'd like to see the ad hoc equity diversity racism committee become a standing committee.
Is there any other discussion or comment from the board?
I agree with that.
Anybody else?
I would appreciate that a lot. I thank Mrs. O'Donnell and for raising that and for the board to consider it. There is one adjustment to make here. It says HCAA Negotiations Ad Hoc Committee. That should read HCEA Negotiations Committee. And then I guess where we have ad hoc committees for policy, especially if the Racism, Equity, and Diversity Committee becomes a standing committee, it might make sense to assign those to standing committees rather than hold separate ad hoc committees for those. Just a thought for
sure.
The board.
Sure. So should we go back to number two and vote on an amended or ask for a motion to reestablish the existing board standing committees and ad hoc committees with the one change of making our Racism, Equity, Diversity Ad Hoc Committee a longstanding committee. So can I have a motion and second on that amended recommendation?
So moved.
Second.
Any more discussion? Can I have a roll call vote, please?
Yes.
Mrs. Blotfeld?
Yes.
Dr. Charney?
Yes.
Mr. Davidson?
Yes.
Mr. Fowler?
Yes.
Mrs. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Kellogg?
Yes.
Mr. Nickel?
Yes.
Mr. Richard?
Yes.
And Mrs. O'Donnell?
Yes.
All yes, motion carries.
Thank you. So next on the agenda, we have our committee new appointments. So we'll just go down that list. Student Life and Program, Mr. Richard will remain chairperson, and the members will be Dee Kellogg and myself.
I apologize. Would you repeat that, please?
Sure. Rob Richard will be chairperson, and the members will be Dee Kellogg and Lisa Hughes.
Thank you.
Operations and Transportation, Mr. Nickel will be chairperson. Dr. Charney, and Mr. Fowler will be members of that committee. Personnel, Mr. Davidson will be chairperson. Mrs. Blotfeld will be a member of that committee. The Racism, Equity, and Diversity Committee, which is no longer ad hoc, will be chaired by Ms. O'Donnell with Mr. Richard as member. The HCEA, as Dr. Moore indicated, needed to be corrected on the agenda negotiations team. I will be chairperson with Mr. Nickel, Mr. Richard, and Ms. Blotfeld as members of that committee. The Ad Hoc Student Discipline Committee, Mrs. Blotfeld will be chairperson with Ms. Kellogg being a member of that committee. Pursuant to Dr. Moore's recommendation, if there's not any discussion on it, we can roll equity policy into the Racism, Equity, Diversity Committee. So the chairperson would be Ms. O'Donnell for that, and Mr. Richard is the member. And the Counseling Policy Ad Hoc Committee will be rolled into the Student Life Committee, with Mr. Richard, Ms. Kellogg, and myself as members of that. So is there any discussion from the board as to those appointments and the changes we've made from the agenda?
Could I ask who was involved in the decision of the committee assignments?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear your question. Who was in charge of the decisions?
Yeah,
I made the decision, okay. Yeah, as president. Any other discussion, questions? Can I have a roll call vote, please? We don't need a motion on that, correct?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So we'll move on to representative appointments. We'll need a motion and a second on this. The following board members will be appointed as follows. Bruce Davidson, delegate for New Jersey School Board Association, with Lori Blotfeld as the alternate. Rob Richard as delegate for the Hunterdon County School Boards Association, with Noelle O'Donnell as alternate. Jeff Charney, representative of Hunterdon County Educational Services Commission. Mr. Fowler, liaison for Hunterdon County Polytech. Mr. Nickel, liaison for Hunterdon Central School Foundation, and Ms. Kellogg for representative in the district on the District Evaluation Advisory Committee. So can I have a motion and a second on those appointments?
So moved.
Second.
Is there any discussion? Hearing none, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Mrs. Blotfeld?
Yes.
Dr. Charney?
Yes.
Mr. Davidson?
Yes.
Mr. Fowler? Mrs. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Kellogg?
Yes.
Mr. Nickel?
Yes.
Mr. Richard?
Yes.
And Mrs. O'Donnell?
Yes.
All yes, motion carries.
Okay, so we'll move on to the revised meeting calendar for January 2022. I need a motion and a second to make the following revisions. The January 3rd Board of Education meeting was canceled. We are here tonight, January 10th, for the Board of Education organizational meeting, and our next meeting will be January 24th, which will be our monthly action meeting.
Can I have a moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Can I have a roll call vote, please?
Mrs. Blotfeld?
Yes.
Dr. Charney?
Yes.
Mr. Davidson?
Yes.
Mr. Fowler? Yes. Mrs. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Kellogg?
Yes.
Mr. Nickel?
Yes.
Mr. Richard?
Yes.
And Mrs. O'Donnell?
Yes.
All yes, motion carries. Did I get everybody? Sorry.
I think so.
I have a blank.
Thank you. Hey, Dr. Moore, do you have a superintendent report?
I do, thank you. And congratulations again, Mrs. Hughes and Mr. Richard, for your elections on the board here into those officership positions. You've both been distinguished by your service here on the board through both celebration and some very difficult times as well, and I'm really looking forward to this next era of board work with you all. I also want to welcome Mrs. Blotfeld and Mr. Fowler to the board. Ms. Blotfeld has experience here, though, and we're happy to welcome her back. Excited to get to work with Mr. Fowler, with whom we've had good conversations both before and after his election to the board, so congratulations to both of you as you begin your terms of service to the school and the community, and congratulations to Mrs. O'Donnell as well on her swearing in for her second term tonight. So we are now situated, and the most important part of our reorganization has now occurred. So now we have officers and a board and committees and all of those things. I do have some updates for you tonight on some COVID issues and concerns. We've certainly seen an increase in cases over the past few weeks, and we've experienced disruptions as a result of the current surge. The amount of contact tracing that we faced coming into school today, as it sort of developed last night, forced us into a remote day today in order to ensure proper accounting under those protocols of who should be in school and who should be staying home. I hate to say it, and I've alerted the board to this fact already, but we're facing the same concern for tomorrow. We joined some of our immediate local schools in that concern as well, and tomorrow will therefore also need to be a virtual day. We'll be sending notices out on that very soon. Nothing saddens me more these days than walking through an empty school. It's a very eerie and very upsetting thing, and these contact tracing protocols, as we work through them, put us in a position where we just can't get that work completed. We just can't get our heads above water is sort of how we feel in a surge like this. As soon as you clear a case out, two more come in. As I said earlier, other schools in our county are feeling the same pressure. The Department of Health models, although we hear some conflicting information about this, depending on who we're talking to at the state level, but they do have this current surge resolving soon. I'm hearing that the hospital is starting to level off in our county in the number of cases that they're seeing as well right now, but things are up and down a little bit. But I do want to count that as good news right now. Some other good news to share is that the CDC has now approved shortened quarantine timelines for schools, and the New Jersey Department of Health has just notified us today that they've adopted those guidelines for use in New Jersey schools and added their own interpretation and guidance. We're working through all of that, and we'll be communicating some more tomorrow. But in short, it reduces quarantine from 10 to 5 days for the vast majority of people who are positive for COVID-19 or are in close contact with someone who is. We're thankful for that, and we'll work to implement that with the revised guidance as soon as we can. I do want to take this opportunity on the board's reorganization to put some of this in the context of our reopening plan. And again, this plan was approved by the board back in August and subsequently certified by the Department of Health and developed in consultation, Department of Education, certified by the Department of Education and developed in consultation with the Department of Health. So I'm just going to put something on the screen real quick for us. If you go to our website, and apologies, our website has been experiencing a few technical issues over the past few days, but it's working much better now. If you go under the quick link section of our website, you can see our 2021-22 safe reopening plan. This is the plan that we filed with the state back in August after board approval. And this plan details every step, more or less, that we've been taking this year, let me clear that, as we've been moving through different phases of the pandemic. So everything is discussed on here. Here's a presentation I gave back in the summer, but everything is discussed here, from masking to vaccination requirements to everything else that we were asked to comment on as a school as we headed into this school year. I also do want to show this chart is a summary of how we've moved through this school year, and it shows some familiar things. So we were in orange for the past several weeks before break, and you can see some familiar turns on here. Considering four lunch blocks, we moved to four lunch blocks as we were reaching the end of our time in orange recently. Masking is required in our plan under orange and red. Under orange, we were still on a full day, every day schedule. Just to flip over to red, because we went red recently in the state's classification, you can see that that has us moving to an early dismissal. We did announce that last week. Masks are still required, and you'll see down here too, we're continuing to limit outside users to our facilities, more out of concern for our operations department being able to support all of the sterilization and disinfection that needs to go on, more out of that than out of any concern about, you know, spread through that facility use. So we have lots of things that we've done here in response to changes in condition with the state. Now, oops, bring this down. Couple of points here on this plan. This plan has no allowance for full-time virtual for all students for any duration of time other than to contend with short-term disruptions like we've had. So last school year, we had several days that we had to take as virtual days to do contact tracing, and the same has happened this year, that we've taken several days, today being one of them, tomorrow being one of them, to complete contact tracing so that we have a proper accounting of which students should be in school and which students should be staying home. That's not going to change. Last year, if we had gone to red, our guidance and our really requirement would have been to go to fully virtual. That's not where we are this year. The plan has us following all of the state mandates and cooperating with Department of Health on contact tracing, using their protocols. It's important to note that the Department of Health has no enforcement power on its own. That's the simple reason why they have all of their publications framed as guidance and recommendations, is because the Department of Health itself has no enforcement power over schools. However, through plans like these, through the acceptance of funding, through various other documents delivered by the Department of Ed and by the governor, we do find ourselves having to implement the Department of Health's recommendations here in school, and that's what's leading to the requirements for contact tracing and our following of the quarantine protocols, which again, we're pleased to see are lightening up and shortening a bit for folks. As far as masking, I mentioned masking through any period of orange or red, we remain masked, and as soon as we go yellow again, then masking becomes an option, like it was when we were in yellow over the summer at different points with summer programs here. As long as mandates don't say otherwise, we're looking forward to that day. There's a lot of discussion right now on the fate of the current masking mandate, but Governor Murphy indicated today that it will remain in effect for the foreseeable future. So as we remain in orange and red, we do continue masking here on campus. And our in-person schedule also, according to our plan, will stay at an early dismissal as long as we're red under our plan. Again, the models are for that red condition to resolve, hopefully soon. I do have to note that while we follow mandates as indicated in our plan, the recent guidance from the DOH to exclude unvaccinated individuals from extracurricular activities does not appear in any of our requirements, and it does not appear in our plan. In fact, our plan states clearly, I go down to, you know, our plan states clearly that we do not plan to require vaccination for participation in any activities here on campus. So the Department of Health, the governor, no one has delivered that as a mandate to us or as a guideline that we need to follow as a condition of any other thing that we would be looking for in terms of funding or any other benefit for the school. And our plan, as approved by the board and as certified by the Department of Ed in consultation with the Department of Health, says that we won't be requiring that. So again, we aren't planning on requiring vaccination for extracurricular activity participation at all. Last week, we were running at about 250 students out on quarantine for being positive, symptomatic, or close contacts. Everyone should remember that students who are out for any of those reasons whenever we're here for in-person instruction really need to reach out to their teachers for information on joining in-person live streamed activities from the classroom. We continue to sit at numbers right now that allow us to handle that scale in this way. That is, trusting our teachers to make the best decisions with individual students based on the activities that are planned in the class for that day. If a teacher is planning a lecture or other activity in which remote students can participate, I fully expect that teacher to invite those remote students into the room through Zoom or Google Meet. If that's not happening, then we need folks here, supervisors and teachers, to know that we might be missing some opportunities for inviting students into those activities. This really remains the best approach for us rather than limiting what teachers can plan through a one-size-fits-all solution, especially when in-person students still represent the vast majority of students, as opposed to last year when on any given day we were running only 30 to 40% of our students in person. I do want to add here as well that mandates do not currently allow students to opt for virtual instruction except under very specific circumstances. There are schools that are broadening that access, but I do feel that to do so is working against the mandates that we have, and I also feel that it doesn't help us as we work to fulfill our principle of maximizing in-person instruction as much as we can for our kids. A school in which large numbers of students are virtual is impacted comprehensively. So the in-person students are impacted as well by the limits that this situation places on teacher lesson planning when large numbers of students are virtual. So we continue, and you've seen the graphic on the screen many times through these conversations. This is all about balancing wellness, educational, and public health goals. And it's a careful, deliberate, but also frustrating, as it has been this week and a little bit of that of last week, frustrating work to do to balance all of that. And all of it, though, I'm proud of and really grateful for the incredible efforts of all of our staff members to continue to help this school move forward as we work through this difficult time right now. It's temporary, we'll get to the other side of it, and we're just we're looking forward for that day to come, hopefully sooner rather than later as we move through this current surge. So thank you all for your support. Thank you, Mrs. Hughes, for the time tonight to deliver that report. Additionally on the agenda, you'll see our monthly HIB summary and suspension summary. Those will be updated again for our meeting on the 24th. And with that, I conclude my report. Thank you.
Can I have a motion and a second on the HIB cases listed on the agenda, please?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, can I have a roll call vote, please?
Mrs. Blotfeld?
All abstain.
Dr. Charney?
Yes.
Mr. Davidson?
Yes.
Mr. Fowler? Mrs. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Kellogg?
Yes.
Mr. Nickel?
Yes.
Mr. Richard?
Yes.
And Mrs. O'Donnell?
Yes.
All yes, motion carries.
Thank you. So now comes the time of the first of our two resident forums for topics on the agenda only. There will be time later for another residence forum for items not on the agenda. Speakers, as always, will be given a maximum of 5 minutes for no more than a total of 30 minutes. So if there's anybody here who'd like to speak for items on the agenda, please come up to the podium, write your name and address.
Visit.
I'm sorry, can you please state your name for the record?
Sure can.
Thank you.
My name is Carol Prignoli. My daughter has Lyme disease, and I have a doctor's note that she doesn't have to wear a mask. You're not honoring it. Mandates are not law. So I would like to tell you that at this point, we're going to have to get to herd immunity.
Okay. Ms. Prignoli, if yes. This is not an item on the agenda, you could speak at the second residence forum, okay?
So what does that mean? I have to wait back there?
Yeah, until we get to the second residence forum, which is items that are not on the agenda.
Okay.
Thank you. Anybody else have anything to speak about that is on the agenda? Okay, hearing none, we'll close the first residence forum. Mr. Nickel, do we have a few items to move from operations and transportation tonight?
Yes. Yes. Actually, there's two things we have. We were looking to authorize our BA to issue a request for proposals for insurance brokerage services, as well as accepting donations from the participants listed on the agenda in the corporate sponsorship program with gratitude. And with that, I'd like to move items J1 and J2.
Second.
Any discussions? Thank you. Hearing none, can I have a roll call vote, please?
Mrs. Blotfeld?
Yes.
Dr. Charney?
Yes.
Mr. Davidson?
Yes.
Mr. Fowler?
Yes.
Mrs. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Kellogg?
Yes.
Mr. Nickel?
Yes.
Mr. Richard?
Yes.
And Mrs. O'Donnell?
Yes.
All yes, motion carries.
Thank you. Additional board business? Does any board members have any business they'd like to discuss at this time? Okay, hearing none, we'll move on to the second residence forum. Same rules as before. You can come up and speak on any items, not necessarily on the agenda, for a maximum of 5 minutes, for a total of 30 minutes. Ms. Prignoli, thank you for being patient. You can come on back up.
This is the third time I'm here. My assistant, thank you so much. So again, masks don't work. It proved it with your staff and your students getting ill. My name is Carol Prignoli, sorry. We're at this point where it's herd immunity. This is gonna end eventually. I can't tell you when, but people get sick and they stay home and then they come back to school. So the mask mandates, again, don't work. I just want to bring up number 4. I want everybody to see this. It's for you and it's for you.
Can you please address the board?
Okay.
Thank you.
The reason my kid didn't come to school last year was number 4, anxiety. It's a terrible thing to wear these masks all day. It's insane and it's crazy. The more important thing is that on these masks, there's toxins. Graphene oxide is on it, and they're also on the swabs, by the way. And there's an article written, graphene oxide on mask and swabs, a poisonous substance. So your kids are wearing a China mask that has poison on it, has a bunch of other things on it as well. The other thing that's interesting in wearing the mask is it causes hypoxia or hypoxemia, causes an increase in CO2. I know you guys know all this, so I don't want to insult you with your time. But let me just tell you, I want to point out number 28. I did a lot of research to get to this point. Number 28 is heart attacks. The article that I read was a 7- and a 9-year-old after gym with their mask on had a heart attack and died. I don't think that's right. It's my right and my child's right to have free air, not to be suffocated for 6 hours a day to get these masks. The second thing is when you want all this testing, on the testing, there's EDTA, causes cancer. By the way, it's also in your mayonnaise, and it's in Chick-fil-A. The second thing is there is also sodium azide. Sodium azide is on the airbags. Now, being an ER nurse for a long time, the airbags, when they deploy, they have this white powder. The white powder is actually cancer-causing. And when they would come into the emergency room, they would have second-degree burns on them. It was pretty amazing to see that. So that's a toxin, that's a killer. I have a lot of research. It causes brain damage. The third thing is that on there, and this just came out, is on the nasal swabs that you demand this testing for, there's the bacteria that causes necrotic fasciitis. That article just came out on 7/1/22. I have that. So the person actually that has it at the present time is an Army person, and they're in the ICU. They're actually very sick, and they could die. I understand that, you know, there's something called the American Rescue Plan that's provided $923 million to New Jersey. They're going to give $10 billion for testing and vaccination of the teachers and the students. That's scary, because I know it's in the vaccines. I've done my research. This is clearly a violation of the Nuremberg Code. I know you're really bored of me hearing my voice. I'm the voice of reason, and I'm really more concerned about your kids.
Ms. Pretinoli, please address the board.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anyway, if you demand the vaccine and testing, you're damaging my child, and it's a violation of the Nuremberg Code, as well as the Constitution of the United States. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Pretinoli.
All right, my name is Wayne Fish. I live in Ringo's. I'm a graduate, former graduate of Hunter Central. As I discussed before, my daughter went here, graduated 3 years ago, and my son Trevor is a junior here. So first off, want to welcome the new board members welcome all the repositioning of board members. In regards to that, you know, the board, you guys are here to represent us, the parents, and obviously you're here for our kids. Moving forward with this new board, hopefully one thing that I would like to see change is the fact that the board just doesn't sit up here with a blank stare every week, that we get up here in front of this microphone and it's like what we say goes in one ear and out the other. It's really disappointing. So if we ask questions, it would be nice if they were addressed in a future board meeting, for one. So I'm just going to start off with that. You know, the last president kind of commented on, hey, today's my last day. You know what? You know what's always here? The board's always here. And you look out in the crowd, it's, yeah, there's not many parents. Well, one reason is probably because we just get, some people get fed up and get tired of not getting answers. So if there's one improvement the board can make, would be addressing our concerns a little bit better. So I really welcome that moving forward with this new adjustment to the board and the new members. So right now, I know that we're virtual, but I want to plan for when the kids do come back to school. So, man, it's the start of this board meeting. We just start announcing and going through all these committees we got. We got a committee for this, a committee for that, and a committee for that, this. Where's our COVID committee to really get together in one united front? CDC is updating the recommended quarantine period time as discussed, so people who are unvaccinated more than 6 months out from their second RNA dose or more than 2 months from the J&J vaccine and not yet boosted, CDC now recommends the 5 days. So nice job, Mr. Moore, where we're now consolidating the 5 days. Pretty funny how we're taking that on now, where weeks ago I kind of brought that up and I was getting no. It's all public knowledge. Anyways, another interesting fact from the CDC. Data from South Africa and United Kingdom demonstrate that the vaccine effectiveness against infection for two doses, vaccine is approximately 35%. A COVID-19 vaccine booster dose restores vaccine effectiveness against infection to 75%. Wow. All I heard, you know, months ago in all this stuff was, got to get the vaccine, you're 100% safe, 100% protected. Amazing how everyone's flip-flopping now. So, COVID-19 vaccination just decreases the risk of the severe disease, hospitalization, and death. As I've stated before, and CDC has come out and agreed, vaccinated people are now getting COVID and spreading it. So I urge you guys to start doing your own homework and stop listening to our censored media. I don't know how you guys feel about censorship, but that's all that's going on right now. Censored media like CNN, MSNBC, Twitter, YouTube, etc. All they're doing is censoring the people that actually have knowledge in this stuff. Do your homework. I recommend, how many of us listen to Spotify or our kids have Spotify? Go and check out Joe Rogan, episode 1757. You have Dr. Robert Malone, MD, inventor of the mRNA vaccine. I'll take his word over the Fauci any day of the week. And I would also recommend, listen, episode 1747, Dr. Peter McCullough. You guys do your research. You ask kids to do homework and research every day. How about you guys start, so maybe you'll understand our perspective on this? Because guess what? You're not seeing these guys go on CNN. You're not seeing them on MSNBC. You're seeing them get kicked off of Twitter. And let me tell you, these people here, they're both are vaccinated, but they're both getting censored for giving accurate COVID and vaccine facts. They discuss the real info behind COVID and getting the vaccine. So if you don't want to hear him on Rogan, you may be able to find him on some other videos, but with the censorship, I'm not so much sure of it. As they are stating, and as we know, kids are not at high risk. The strain of COVID is just like dealing with the regular flu at this point. So with all this info, vaxxed, unvaxxed, I heard a bunch of things as far as reopening, Dr. Moore. One thing I didn't get here, that I didn't hear get addressed, which I've talked about in the past two board meetings, and thus my point on how we want to start getting responses from you guys and that you're just not a cardboard cutout up here listening to us, is, you know, are we to the point now that we are going to treat all the kids the same? Seriously, it doesn't matter, vaxxed or unvaxxed, they're kids. We want consistency with all the kids.
Thank you, Mr. Fish.
So, contact tracing.
Mr. Fish, your 5 minutes.
I'll take time for someone else.
Mr. Fish, thank you. Your
5 minutes.
Listen,
you've been a little rude your first day up here.
Mr. Fish,
with people here.
Your 5 minutes.
Can you hear me out for 2 seconds?
I was going to ask of you that I would appreciate if you sent an email to me telling me what concerns or questions have not been addressed by the board, and I will absolutely do my best to have any of those questions or concerns answered.
Oh, she's going to let me take her spot. Thank you. So I'm going to wrap this up. I have three more things. Just hear me out. Thank you.
Wrap up. Thank you.
So I will. So contact tracing. If you send some kids home, you have to send home all the kids that were in that contact tracing, whether they're vaxxed or unvaxxed at this point. That should have kind of been announced in this thing tonight when you're going over your reopening plans. Secondly, contact tracing. So commonplace seems to have been in the lunchroom. I get that a lot with all the parents I talk to. But you state cases every day, but can we get specific numbers on where those are coming? Is it the lunchroom or is it the classroom? And then, you know, if it's a classroom, how is this possible? Because in the classroom, you guys are supposed to be keeping accurate distancing and masks. So is it the fact that the school is not doing our job protecting our kids? So I get maybe if you want to say that the lunchroom, they don't have the masks on. And then kids are being sent home involving these two locations. I'm curious, how much contact tracing has led to the gym? As I brought up in the last board meeting, and my son here, listen, I'm glad that he has a gym for resources to work out. He's a dual sport athlete here, but I haven't heard of one incident in the gym. The reason I bring up the gym, kids are packed in the gym right now, 30 to 50 kids at a time, because they're now teaming up football with lacrosse, with maybe volleyball or soccer, whatever the, you know, the thing is. You have 30 to 50 kids working out in that gym, and guess what, guys? None of them have masks on. So if you haven't contact traced one thing from that gym right now, what does that tell you about these masks that the kids are wearing?
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Fish.
You have
Fish.
Your own research right here.
Thank you.
So, indeed, this is an
Mr. Fish, I've gone. I've given you an additional time. Ms. Spitzer, I don't have the gavel, so we'll just go into recess if necessary. I would ask respectfully that you please send me an email with your questions or concerns, and I will be happy to address them.
So
we appreciate
like
your feedback.
President Biden, just like with Dr.
Thank you, Mr. Fish. We'll go to recess, and then we'll have to shut down the residence forum for a few minutes. Thank you. I'd like to call recess of the meeting, please. I'm taking a brief recess and ask that you please take your seat. You've had your 5 minutes and beyond. For other residents to speak, 30 minutes total. Thank you.
Mrs. Hughes?
Okay, everybody ready? Can I have a motion and a second to return to public session, please?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Can I have a roll call vote, please?
Yes. Dr. Charney?
Here.
Mr. Davidson?
Yes.
Mr. Fowler?
Yes.
Mrs. Hughes?
Yes.
Mrs. Kellogg?
Yes.
Mr. Nickel?
Yes.
Mr. Richard?
Yes.
And Mrs. O'Donnell?
Yes.
Thank you. Before we return to residence forum, I would like to say that everyone is welcome here and welcome to speak. What I do ask is that people please follow the rules as clearly stated on our agenda. Every person has 5 minutes to speak. There are several people who want to speak tonight. There are two separate sections for issues on the agenda, issues off the agenda, which is why I asked Ms. Prignoli to please come back and speak at the second session because her issue was not related to the agenda. Everyone is welcome to speak. We just ask that you please follow the rules and be respectful. So do we need a motion, Ms. Spitzer, to return to residence forum? Okay. So we will continue now our second residence forum for any items that are not on the agenda necessarily. If there's anybody else who would like to speak, please come up to the podium, state your name and address, and write it on the form. Thank you.
Hello, my name is David. I'm from Reddington Township.
David, can we have your last name, please?
Rizza.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, so I'm going to follow up on some of Wayne's comments, specifically about treating students the same, whether they're vaccinated or unvaccinated. The comment I would like to start with is in regard to the contact tracing program. I want to reference an email that Nancy Tucker sent on December 30th in regards to contact tracing. In her email, she stated that if you are fully vaccinated, you do not need to quarantine. Please provide proof of vaccination. She further states, if not fully vaccinated, you need to quarantine for 5 to 7 days until your test for 5 to 7 days is negative, and then you may return to school on day 8. I know that's been changed to 5 days, but you're still changing it from vaccinated to unvaccinated and treating its children differently. I also want to bring up another email that Dr. Moore sent to a colleague of mine in regards to the extracurricular. And in there, I'm just going to read it as a short email. And he wrote, you're correct. The Department of Health guidance for regions that move to the red includes a recommendation to limit extracurricular activities, participation to vaccinated students. However, in our safe reopening plan, which was approved by the BOE and certified the Department of Education, we state, unless mandated to do otherwise, we do not plan to require vaccinations for students for any opportunity or activity. Going to school would be an opportunity or have activity, you know, but anyway, for any opportunity or activity. The guidance from the Department of Health in this issue is not a mandate, and we do not require vaccination for extracurricular activities. So what I would like to reiterate is that you have two different standards, one for extracurricular activities that don't require treating students differently, and one for contact tracing, where you require now for 5 days for them to be quarantined. So it's inconsistent, and we would like, or I would request, that you treat contact tracing the way you treat the unvaccinated for extracurricular. I also want to bring up a couple things about the Omicron variant that I'm sure has been in the news and everyone here has read it, and specifically that vaccinated persons are spreading the virus equal to or greater to than unvaccinated. Specifically, Dr. Fauci's quoted as saying very recently, we know now that as a fact that vaccinated people with COVID-19 are capable of transmitting the infection to someone else. Dr. Walensky, head of CDC, what vaccines can't do anymore is prevent transmission. Dr. Sachs, CMO of Moderna, there's no hard evidence that stops a COVID-19 vaccinated from potentially infecting others who have not been vaccinated. Some things have been in the news. The CEO of a hospital in California, currently 57% of our hospitalized COVID patients are fully vaccinated. And last, an article from The Lancet, which is one of the top medical journals in the U.S., actually in the world, in December wrote, 89% of new United Kingdom COVID cases are among fully vaccinated. To go further into that, between weeks 39 and 42, a total of 100,000 COVID-19 cases were reported among citizens greater than 6 years old. 89,000 were among the fully vaccinated, 89.7%. Only 3,300 were among the unvaccinated, which is 3.4%. The rest were partially vaccinated. So based on that, you can obviously see vaccinated are spreading the disease. Omicron is actually higher than the unvaccinated. So to have two different policies where you treat two sets of students different doesn't seem to make sense. You should treat them the same way you treat extracurricular. So the one question is, I know you're going to answer questions at the end, I'm going to ask you, do you agree with the above medical doctors and that vaccinated spread the disease equal to or greater than unvaccinated, as the quotes I just gave you? And the second question I would like you to address is, will you reconsider following the Department of Health guidelines in regards to contract tracing and treat students the same as opposed to treating them as different classes of people? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rizza. I'd like to remind everybody that masking is required on school grounds at all times. Thank you.
Thank you for this opportunity to speak. My name is Vernon Williams. I live at 2 Frost Court in Raritan Township. First of all, I want to welcome to our new board members who have just been sworn in on tonight. And I want to thank you as the board for being thoughtful, for being direct, and for caring for our children. I am a parent who believes that masking works. I'm a parent who believes that vaccines work. I'm a parent who understands that when you were vaccinated, never meant you were not going to, you could not necessarily contract this virus, nor that you could spread it. I thank you all for doing your work, for understanding what your duty and task is to ensure that my child, my junior, and every other child that's in this district, that's in this school, is safe. And so I thank you for what you are doing as a board. I know it is not easy. I know it is not difficult. I do believe that you expect and have my child's best interest at heart. And so for that, thank you. And so please understand that there are many, many parents who, like me, who understand what we are dealing with and appreciate the job that you are trying to do to ensure that our children continue and maintain their health and their safety. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. William. Okay, is there anybody else who'd like to speak at residence forum? Otherwise, we'll close the second residence forum.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Jason Fish from Flemington, New Jersey. I'd like to welcome all the board members for the third time this evening. I came up here to address the board for a couple of different instances. The first one I'd like to talk about is the vaccinated versus the unvaccinated. I'm not sure if everybody knows, my daughter had to quarantine for 14 days when she was contact traced at the high school. And she quarantined for the 14 days. Couple of days with her getting back into the school system, one of her best friend's parents, fully vaccinated, came down with COVID. But because her friend was vaccinated, the school system allowed the mother's daughter to go back to school and not have to quarantine. We talk about contact tracing. The mother and daughter live in the same house. They share the same kitchen, the same bathroom, the same family room. How could you permit that child to go back to school when the mother was diagnosed with COVID? All we're asking for you to treat the students equally. And I know that's a hard decision that you guys have to make. You guys are following guidance from the health department, and your job is not easy. I certainly wouldn't want to be where you guys are sitting right now. But we do ask for freedom, and we do ask for fairness, and for you to be reasonable. The next thing I'd like to discuss is the symptoms of this new Omicron variant. If you look at those in great detail, they look just like the cold and the flu. And because we've been dealing with this pandemic for the past year and a half, almost 2 years now, everybody is on a heightened level of awareness, and they're nervous. And some people are afraid to go out of the house, and some people are afraid to go to stores, and some students may be afraid to go to the classroom. But if those students are not feeling well, and they're not feeling up to going to school that day, the school system should provide for the students to log in when they're not feeling well and have symptoms that may or may not be Omicron, but maybe a cold or flu. They should be able to log in. We have some neighboring school districts that offer those services, and you might want to reach out to them to see how well it's working for them. You have Bridgewater Township offers these services where students can log in and attend their class virtually. And you also have Watchung Hills that's doing that as well. So please reconsider that policy. And for those who are nervous about going into school or infecting other classmates or other faculty or teachers, let them stay home until they're feeling well enough to go back to school. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Fish. There's no one else that is coming up to the mic to speak now. We will close our second residence forum. Do we have any board comments from any of our board members? Or Dr. Moore, any comments that you'd like to make?
Yeah, I'll share a couple of thoughts. Can't tell you how many times I've had a conversation today about, well, gee, Jeff, you didn't sign up for this when you became a superintendent, did you? I think some of you in the room had that conversation with me today at different times. And it's true on one hand, but on the other hand, it's exactly what we signed up for. I'm an expert in very specific things, as we all are. I'm an expert in secondary education. I'm an expert in educational technology and strategic planning. I am not an immunologist. I'm not a public health official. I've learned an awful lot about these things and meteorology in my time here, but I'm not an expert in those things. And I rely on the partnerships that I have with experts to inform me on what we need to do. I'm not really a person who is ready to question those determinations because they're coming from people who I trust as experts, friends and colleagues who work in this county, who are neighbors of ours, just like you're all neighbors of ours, who are advising us on very specific things. We do not make up contact tracing protocols. We don't write them. We don't determine what's right or wrong in them. We rely on the experts that we work with to tell us how that ought to proceed. The thing that I know about contact tracing protocols with vaccinated versus unvaccinated, which is an interesting point, I don't know that it's convincing toward any argument, but it's just interesting to note, there have always been differences between vaccinated people and unvaccinated people in contact tracing protocols. I go back to whooping cough years ago. Vaccinated folks are treated differently in those contact tracing protocols and always have been than unvaccinated people because there's science that speaks to different outcomes and different dangers and different considerations. I've been a vocal critic here of these protocols. I've advocated strongly for shortened quarantine timelines. I've advocated strongly for better data for schools. I'm out there fighting a lot of the fight that you would hope that I'm out there fighting to get better information and better decisions for schools in this really unique situation. In this, you know, I do feel like I'm answering some questions again and again. Our students who are out for symptoms, our students who are out on quarantine for any reason, they do have access to online live instruction. All they need to do is reach out to their teachers. And as I said earlier, if teachers aren't affording that for any reason, that's something we want to know about and we want to understand why. But it is something that we expect as an opportunity for our kids. Are we going to turn on the cameras and live stream every single thing that goes on in the room? I don't think that's a good use for all of our students' time when they're at home. If our kids are engaged in a hands-on activity or a lab or something like that, I think the teacher working with that student is another expert I trust to determine what's the best thing for that student to be doing. So I surround myself with experts. If I have any success, I owe it to that fact. I surround myself with people who are smart, and I rely on their counsel. In this situation, we have protocols that are handed to us from a state agency. Are there things I don't like about them? Sure. The last thing I want to do is walk around this school tomorrow and have the silence that we had today. That's the very last thing I want to do. That's going to set me up for a really awful evening tomorrow night as I sit and reflect on how we're doing as a community with our kids. But these are the protocols we have. The protocols that are going to be handed down now on a shortened quarantine timeline, they may continue to treat vaccinated and unvaccinated students differently. They may not line up exactly with what the CDC has put out. We only just received them a few hours ago. We have some digestion to do. So we're going to let everybody know tomorrow what we find there, and we're going to follow what's handed to us from the Department of Health in order to continue to work with and trust the experts with whom we work with as we're trying to get through this. I know this will be over soon. I know we've made an awful lot of progress. I am indebted, as I said earlier, indebted to and really grateful for all the work that's gone on here. I'm conscious of the frustrations of our approaches, of the approaches that all schools are forced into right now, but it's a frustrating time. It'll end soon, and we'll be back to doing all day, every day, what we want to be doing with kids, hopefully without masks, hopefully without contact tracing. But right now, this is what we've got. And the experts are the folks that I need to continue to listen to in order to achieve the standard of care that I need to achieve for the students here. And those experts are handing me protocols from agencies in Trenton that are pretty clear to me on what I have to do. We're not writing them. We're not adjusting them. We're following what's given to us by the experts. I understand the frustrations of that, and I apologize for it, but that's the position that I have to be in as your superintendent. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Moore. So if we have no other board comments, we're going to move into executive session to discuss legal and negotiations, I believe?
Just legal.
Just legal, with no action to be taken upon our return. Thank you. Can I in a second to move into executive session for about 20 minutes to 30 minutes? Did we have a second?
Second.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
20 minutes.